And I just want to say just a few words of welcome, because you want to hear from Xuping and not from me. But let me begin by saying that it really is a tremendous honor for me to be able tonight to formally welcome Xuping to Cambridge. We are delighted that he has been able to find the time to come here for a whole week in what I know is a very, very busy time for him, as he is preparing a very large installation for the Viennese, for the Venice Biennale in this month or so, a 30-meter phoenix that is going to be there. Xuping is already the fourth holder of the Humanitas Professorship in Chinese Studies. And over the last 4 years, we have been considering from various angles the topic of what is China? What was or what is the Chinese Revolution? In what ways does the past impact on China today? A question that can also be asked in reverse, of course. In examining these themes, we have profited from the learning and wisdom of three eminent scholars, Professor Chen Yongfa from, from Taiwan, Professor David Derwei Wang from Harvard, as well as Professor Wu Hong from Chicago, who is, I learned yesterday, a classmate of Xuping from Beijing. Xuping, I'm sure, will help us further extend our understanding of that topic, precisely because he does not address it through scholarship, as our previous professors have done, but through his art, asking even more fundamental issues, including about the whole nature of, as I'm sure we all know, of writing, a key medium through which we communicate and through which the past continues to speak to us, no matter how difficult. Xuping, in his most famous installation piece, as we know, in the book from the sky, took on that topic. And I'm convinced that at the end of this week, when Xuping unfortunately has to rush back to Venice, or perhaps fortunately for him, since it's such a lovely place, we will all have gained a great deal. I will leave my introductory comments short, because you want to hear from Professor Xu rather than me, and also because Professor Xu will speak in Chinese rather than English, and therefore there will be a translator, Ms. Tan here, who will help us with that. But let me just say a few things. Professor Xu was born in Sichuan, in Chongqing, from parents who had worked in the CCP underground. Soon, though, the family moved to Beijing, where Professor Xu grew up, and where he attended the Central Academy of Fine Arts, specializing in printmaking and calligraphy. And Xuping moved to the United States in 1990, and then would stay there until 2008, when he returned to China to take up the vice directorship of the Central Academy of Fine Arts. Professor Xu has received very many highly prestigious awards, including a MacArthur Fellowship, United States, which is of course also known as the Genius Award, the Fukuoka Asian Culture Prize, as well as an honorary doctorate from Columbia University. And I think one of the things that has always impressed me about his work, and I'm not at all an art historian, is the seriousness of the questions that are asked, but also sort of the playfulness with which that is done. And something that sort of I know from Dutch art in Amsterdam a little bit. And I think that is a theme that we will return to on the last lecture that he will deliver to us on Wednesday. I must take this opportunity, of course, to thank a number of people. And I first of all would like to thank James, who is here somewhere, James from the Fitzwilliam Museum, the China curator, as well as Michelle Maciejewska, who was sitting there from CRASSH. They have done very much the heavy lifting in making Professor Xu's visit possible. And that is not an understatement at all. They have done tremendous amounts of work to make all this possible and to set us up for this wonderful week that we're going to have. I also would like to thank Sir David Tang, who has made this series financially possible, and whose suggestion is underpinning the Humanitas Professorship in Chinese Studies, And of course, I also need to thank the Weidenfeld-Hoffmann Trust, who is sort of the overarching body that administers all these humanities professorships, both at Oxford as well as here. And then generally, I need to thank CRASSH for the support it has given to Chinese studies and is continuing to do so. Before handing over to Professor Xu, let me also provide you a brief rundown of the week's activities. So Professor Xu will give us two lectures. The theme today is on the reactivation of tradition, which is of course central to his work. And then the topic for Wednesday is the energy of reality. And both these two lectures take place here. And then there is a concluding symposium on Thursday afternoon, which will be held in the Darwin Room at the Pitt Building, which is over there somewhere. And if you want to come to that, you do need to sign up through the CRASSH website. And I'm delighted to announce, too, that the Fitzwilliam Museum will display an installation consisting of four interesting bird cages. And they can be seen, I think that's right, James, from Wednesday. Yeah? Okay, good. There will be an opening tomorrow. And with that, please join me in welcoming Professor Xu and come to talk to us.
So thank you, Professor Hans. It gave a good introduce. Yeah. So, and lots of people I should say thanks. Yeah. But it's Professor Hans already thanks. Yeah. So as I want to use the Chinese to talk, then Tan Zili can help with the translation. 因为在这儿是这个。 剑桥大学，所以我得谈的认真一点，所以中文就可以谈的比较准确一点。
Because this is a Cambridge University, and I really want to be serious, and I want to use Chinese so it's accurate.
当然感谢大家今天下午跟我们那个享受这个时间。
And thank you very much for coming here this afternoon.
这个我今天的题目呢是第一讲的题目是这个传统的激活，我是想通过这个。 就是我的创作的这个十多年的几十年的创作的经验呢，和这个案例呢，分析一下，就是说，作为艺术家身上所携带的这个传统文化的基因呢，是如何在我们的实践中，被转换和发挥作用的。And
my first lecture is called the reactivation of the tradition. And I want to talk about my over 10 years experience as an artist and how does the tradition, the DNA of tradition play its role in my artistic production.
这个以及呢，就是今天的中国为什么是个样子，和我们今天中国的很多的现象为什么是个样子。
I would also like to explore how China become what it is today and why there are
these phenomenons in China.
I would like to explore how this phenomenon in China is connected to the tradition that we do not understand but which exists in us.
我是想说一下这个，先说一下这个，作为中国的文化传统到底是什么东西。
First, I would like to talk about what is Chinese tradition.
而且它是怎么样遗存在我们的这个文化的 DNA 中间的。
And how this cultural tradition continues to exist in our cultural DNA.
在我看来呢，中国的文化传统或者说中国的传统文化中呢，其实呢它是很丰富的，而且它是多层次的。
In my opinion, the Chinese cultural tradition, we can call it the Chinese traditional culture, is very rich and it has many layers.
Yeah. 所以呢，我认为呢，它其实有一个大传统。我所说的大传统呢，就是整体的一个中国的传统的文化。
I divide the Chinese tradition into two parts. The first part I call it the big tradition, the general tradition of China.
可以说是传统的文化。
And we can call it the traditional culture.
我认为呢，它其实在这个里面还有一个小的传统，这个小的传统呢，其实我认为是近代以来的，特别是这个社会主义时期以来的这个所形成的一种文化现象和这个传统。
And the second part of the Chinese tradition, I call it a small tradition, which comes into form during the socialist period.
当然在我们的这两个传统的部分之外呢，还有一个很重要的一个传统。 就是我们学习西方的一个经验实践的这样的一个传统。And
apart from these two parts of tradition, I think there's another very important part about Chinese tradition, which comes from our learning from the Western culture.
就是如何使用西方的传统，就是如何使用西方的文化。 其实已经成了我们这个传统文化中非常重要的经验。
The Chinese people learn how to apply the Western culture in our practice, and this has also become part of our tradition.
我们必须要包括这一部分才能够认清楚我们的传统。
And we need to understand this part of the tradition to have a clear understanding of the Chinese tradition.
我是想说这个下面一个问题，我就想说。 这些传统是怎么样遗传在我们的这个文化的DNA中的
And the second part I would like to talk about is how these traditions, this culture continue to exist in our cultural DNA.
我们可以分析一下，就是说在中国的整个的这个历史的进程中，特别是我们这一代人，或者说49年以后，其实呢。 从这个总体的概念上来讲呢，或者总体的认识上来讲呢，我们的传统是被隔断的。And
we can see that in the Chinese history, especially after 1949, we could see there was a dislocation in Chinese culture.
特别是到了文革呢，这种隔断和这个对过去文化的一种破坏或者毁灭和改造，其实是前所未有的。
Especially the Cultural Revolution, which I think is a barrier against the older history of China, which was a destroy for the previous culture.
但是呢，那个下面就引出两个问题，就是说，但是我们这一代中国人，为什么在我们的文化中仍然呢有很强的中国的传统的方式的这种遗传？
Talking about that, then we have questions. That is, even though there was a dislocation, why this generation of Chinese people still has a very strong heritage from the Chinese history, the historical culture?
这些方法呢，其实被运用于我们的日常的生活每一个细节，以及整体的这个国家的发展与建设中。
This sort of cultural heritage exists in our daily life. And also, it appears in the development of the whole country.
这个我们后边会谈到。
Which we'll talk about later today.
但是我们这一代人呢，实际上呢，并没有受到过一个完整的一个知识的教育和这个阅读的一个过程。
However, I can say that our generation of Chinese people, we did not have a very complete cultural education. We did not have a complete reading of the culture.
但是呢，在我看来呢，实际上这个我们的这个传统文化是怎么样被我们所接受的？我想谈第一点，就是说，实际上中国的这个文化的这个核心的部分哈，它有的时候呢未必是在被记载的文字的材料中。
And so how we inherited this Chinese culture, I want to say that actually the essence of Chinese culture, actually they do not exist in the written records.
实际上在中国人的哲学和文化中呢，对文字，实际上它带有某种程度的，就是一个是不信任，再一个呢是什么呢？就是说把文字作为一种 文化的形式被尊重和保存着。
嗯 Well, actually, in the Chinese thinking, we actually do not trust written recording, or we do not trust the text completely. The language, the text, is only a form to convey the culture.
所以呢，这个虽然我没有读太多的书，这一代人，但是呢，我们对文化的这种继承和这个这种延续呢，实际上呢，要我说非常重要的一部分是来自于你身边的人和特别是你父母的言行所接受的。
So our generation of people, we did not have a lot of readings. However, we continued the Chinese tradition. And this tradition actually comes from people around us, especially our parents, from our observance of how they behave in their daily life.
特别是什么呢？特别是比如说你周围的人，或者说你喜欢的人，或者是你崇拜的人，特别是你的父母，他们的说话的方式。和接人待物的方式，他们的说话的语气，和他们说话的节奏，和他们处理事情的方法，这些东西呢，实际上呢是作为这个文化中非常的内在的一条线索和非常核心的部分被我们所接受的，它带有一定的生理的这种继承性。
Well, actually, we learn the Chinese tradition, the Chinese culture, from our parents or other people we like or we respect. We observe how they talk. We observe their intonation, their punctuation, their way of speaking. We observe how they interact with the people around them, and we observe how they approach problems. And this helps us to carry on the essence of the tradition.And this is almost like a physical memory of the culture.
所以我们说孔子作为中国文化的非常重要的一个部分。实际上他的思想呢，都是他的学生对他的言行和跟随他的过程中，记录了他如何接人待物，见到什么人是如何行礼，出现了什么样的事件或者什么样的问题，他怎么样解决，包括他的对人的态度等等这些东西呢，被他的学生记录下来呢，成为中国文化中很重要的一部分。
We all know that Confucius is very important in Chinese culture, and actually all our memories of Confucius comes from the records of his followers. And the followers, they observe how he Confucius behaved, and they observed their attitude toward different things and people, and they observed how Confucius deals with the problems, and all these records become a part of Chinese culture.
所以中国文化其实讲究行止了，就是说什么时候该动作，什么时候该行为，什么时候该停止等等，这些都是孔子的思想。实际上这些处理事情的节奏，和轻重，是我们这个文化中非常重要的内容。
And in Chinese culture, we talk about when to act and when is appropriate to stop. And this actually comes from the recording of the behavior of Confucius. It comes from observing how he solved the problems.
所以我这就可以说，虽然呢，传统文化被社会，形式所这个隔断，但是呢。仍然有非常深的遗传性在我们的血液中。
So this is why I believe that although there was a cultural dislocation in Chinese history, however, the Chinese tradition still exists in our DNA.
另外一点呢，就是说这个虽然是通过了文革或者社会主义时期，大规模的对文化的破坏，或者我们说这个社会主义的这个文化的特征。
So we saw that China experienced the Cultural Revolution and the Socialist period, where the traditional culture was destroyed.
但实际上呢，这东西它的里头这中国的事情的复杂性就在于，即使社会主义时期和文革的方法，实际上它内部呢有很多的核心的方法呢，其实是中国传统文化的方法，或者说中国传统文化中有一句话叫"以他人"。 以他人之道还其他人之身，对吧？哈，就实际上呢，这个毛的文化其实用了很多的这个中国传统的文化的方法来隔断和反对这个传统。
And actually, I think there's a complexity about the history or the culture of China that we need to understand. In Chinese, we have a saying that you use exactly the enemy's method to revenge upon the enemy. And during the Cultural Revolution, that was exactly what Chairman Mao did. He used a lot of traditional method to destroy the traditional culture, to act as a barrier against the traditional culture.
实际上呢，这个首先这毛这个人，他其实大量的读了很多的古书的，嗯，因为文革的时候呢，他即使后来的眼睛啊都很看不见了，你知道吧？完全都看不见，但是他还是仍然很喜欢读书，所以呢，他呢就请那个，就他每个星期要开一个书单的，然后呢交给下面的人，这下面的人呢在。 一个星期之内或者两个星期之内就要把他开的这个书单呢都给印成大字本，嗯，都给印成大字本，而且大字本呢是什么呢？就是说是，竖排的，大字儿的，这个一册一册的，非常的那个便捷的。
Well, first thing we need to understand about Chairman Mao is that he reads extensively and he enjoys reading large volume of Chinese classics. And even at the later stage of his life, he was losing his eyesight, but he was continuing to read. And every week he would give his staff a list of books that he would like to read in the next 1 or 2 weeks. And within that 1 or 2 weeks, the staff needed to print out the books that Chairman Mao wants to read in the traditional way that from top to bottom and with the larger size of characters so he can read easily.
中国的传统的书为什么线装而且竖排的，而且都很轻？你看西方的书都很厚，很重，就是他把西方其实把这个书作为一个这本一本书。 他给这个装饰的极其的华美和神圣，感觉这个世界的所有都在这本书里面。 Well,
one thing we can see between Chinese books and the Western books is that Chinese books are always very concise and very light, but the Western books, they're always very heavy with the extravagant decorations, so they appear to be very sacred, they appear to contain all the knowledge in the universe.
这个中文的书它竖排呢，而且它是软的，它是可以卷起来的，所以呢，这个文人哈，毛主席呢，就是躺着那看书的，你知道吧？所以他呢，他可以卷着那书又很轻，他可以读。如果让他读圣经，他是没法躺着读的。
And Chinese books, they run from top to bottom, and they're very lightweight, and you can roll it easily, you can carry it easily. And Chairman Mao, he enjoyed the reading lying on the bed. And so these kind of books was very easy for him to read. If you ask Chairman Mao to lie on the bed and read the Bible, he couldn't possibly do that.
Yeah, 这个当然我们下面再说，就是说他的具体的很多的方法，我只举几个例子，比如说呢。 毛建立了一种口号式的一种方法，这种口号式方法就是说，他一定要把复杂的事情，用最简洁的口号式的，而且是朗朗上口的方法传达给全国人民。So
we talk about some methods of Chairman Mao during the Cultural Revolution. One thing he used was slogans, which can summarize very complicated things in a very simple sentence. And also very easy to read.
而这种方法呢，被历代的领导人所继承，包括现在的习近平，也是每一代领导人都要有这个自己建立的朗朗上口的口号。And
actually, generations of leaders in China all use this kind of slogans. The previous president, the current president Xi Jinping, also uses slogans. All the leaders in China, they have their own slogans and catchphrases.
比如说在毛的那个阶段，实际上呢，比如说他工业，他就有工业学大庆的一个说法，农业呢，他就有农业学大寨这样的说法，这就解决了农业的问题。
For example, what Chairman Mao used was that for industry development, we need to learn from the Daqing oil field. And for agricultural development, we need to learn from Dazhai, which was very concise.
部队的事呢, 就是团结紧张, 严肃活泼。
And for the military army, and the catchphrase at that time was that they need to have a solidarity and they need to be dedicated, serious, but at the same time, they need to have a sort of a playfulness.
比如说部队和人民,全国人民的关系就是全国人民学解放军,解放军学全国人民。
And he also used a very simple sentence to summarize the relationship between the People's Liberation Army and the Chinese people, which is that the PLA needs to learn from the Chinese people while the Chinese people need to learn from the PLA.
比如说我这张片子，咱们可以把这灯关一点吗？好，嗯，比如说这个，比如说这张这个东西呢，我为什么最开始放了一个这个呢？这个实际上是在我当时在文革后期去农村插队的时候，我和当地的农民和当地的知识青年，我们一起做的一本文学艺术的刊物。
On this slide, you can see it's a book I made during the Cultural Revolution when I was in the countryside with the farmers. And with the farmers and some intellectuals, we created this magazine for literature and arts.
我们可以看到这个，比如铁书记，其实就是实际上是从那个王铁人的这个概念过来的。那边那什么学大寨什么的，是吧？然后呢，什么等等的这些都带有这种，这是新民歌，新民歌就是说 把所有的口号都转换成民歌，民歌就是一种最通俗易懂的一种口号的排列，其实是。So
on this slide, you can see the title of this article is called "The Iron Party Secretary," which is a story of a party secretary whose name is Wang Tianren at that time. And also here are some folk songs, but they are a new type of folk songs that are made up of slogans.
我为什么这个说一通这些东西和我们的传统有什么关系？实际上呢，中国的传统的文化的传承，很重要的都是由这样朗朗上口的三字所组成的，所谓三字经也好，是吧？哈。 等等等等的这样的这各种各样的这个经典文本，其实都是由这种口号式的整齐的语句所传承下来的。So
why I talk about this? Because this is very closely related to the heritage of Chinese culture. In Chinese culture, we can find a lot of three-character slogans like this, including the very famous classic called the three-character classics.
就是说这个中国的这个文化呢，其实到了49年以后和文革的时候呢，它其实是通过了一种这种变异，就这个异化了以后的传统，而又把 这个某些精髓保留的方式被我们继承下来的。So
during after 1949 and during the Cultural Revolution, well, I can say that the Chinese culture has been modified into a new form, but it still keeps the essence of Chinese tradition.
下面呢，我再放几张片子。这几张片子实际上我就是在谈什么，就是说 这个传统呢，它的这种顽强性和它把所有的东西，就所有东西它都要最后和自己这个传统扯到一起。And
next I would like to show a couple of slides. And what I want to talk about here is the resistance of the Chinese tradition, that it can actually include very different foreign things and actually make them part of Chinese culture.
它实际上是，其实中国文化中有一个特点，就是说它总是这个声东击西的，你知道吧？它是说这个事儿， 其实他在说别的事儿。
One characteristic of Chinese culture is that a lot of times it appears to be talking about one thing, but actually it's talking about a completely different thing.
比如说这个我们呢，这个由于冷战哈，西方呢一直搞当代艺术，开始搞现代艺术，但是由于冷战，中国是封闭的，和西方没有沟通，所以我们一直在沿袭欧洲的十九世纪的素描的训练的方法，而且到现在我们回过头来发现，哟，原来我们把这个传统继承得很好。
During the Cold War, China was completely isolated from the rest of the world. At that time, the Western world was already starting contemporary arts, but China was still continuing to learn the 19th century European pencil sketching, and ultimately we found out that we actually excel at pencil sketching.
这个是我当时的就是一个素描的训练的一个过程，这些画呢，实际上呢，那个就是非常的欧洲的风格。
You can see these were my works during that time, and they are very European.
然后呢，那个前年了，就是在那个 CRASSH Humanitas Visiting Museum, 就是由那个 Fitzwilliam Museum, 他今天也到了，我很高兴，策划了一个关于我的风景画的一个展览，里面就展览了一些我的这些素描。
Actually, I think it was 2013. I had an exhibition in the CRASSH Humanitas Museum in Oxford University, and one of the exhibition planners here today, which I'm very happy and grateful. And that was an exhibition of landscape paintings, and some of these paintings on the slide were at that exhibition.
对，然后这个展览呢，其实很多人反映，哟，说徐冰这个素描画的确实很好啊。我说在中国，只要艺术学院毕业的学生，差不多都能画这么好。
And many people at that time were saying that, oh, Xu Bing, you're so good at these sketchings. And I told them that as far as you are a graduate from art academy in China, you must excel at it.
就是说这个，当然这个。中国艺术家受的用这么多的时间来学习西方的这套方法，实际上有很多原因，比如说这个我们非常崇洋媚外，这是一个原因，这是肯定的。再一个呢，当时呢冷战呢，这种严峻的形势，中国大陆需要写实的艺术来歌颂这个国家，来保卫这个国家，所以呢就推崇了写实的艺术。
So there are different reasons for this learning from this Western artistic methods. One of the reasons is that Chinese people just love anything that's foreign, that's Western. And the second reason was that during the Cold War, which was a very critical period in Chinese history, we actually really needed something realistic to protect the country. And that was why the realistic art school was popular at that time.
Yeah. 当然呢，我今天想强调一个，还有一个很重要的原因是什么呢？是实际上呢，这套方法，中国人把它转换成了和中国传统的教育的方式很吻合的一种方法。
But what I want to emphasize here today is that although this is a Western art approach, but Chinese people actually adapted it to the traditional education method in China.
为什么这么说呢？就是说，因为我在中央美术学院教素描，教这种课程，教素描，画这些什么，这种长期的什么这种作业，我教了很多年，有十多年，在我去美国之前啊，那这个，这套方法呢，实际上我后来发现呢，并不是仅仅是让艺术家学会把一个东西画像，而真正重要的收获在于，至少我自己的体会在于，这个它让我从一个粗糙的人变为一个精致的人。
I actually spent over 10 years in the Central Academy of Fine Arts in Beijing, teaching sketching, before I went to the States. And during that 10 years, I realized that learning sketching is not actually to teach a person to draw a thing, an object, and in reality, it is actually teaching you how to become a more refined person.
Yeah, 实际上呢，是我们长期的在那磨，我们叫磨铅笔头，你知道吧？就是在那磨铅笔，磨磨磨，这么一张作业画一个月、两个月这样的，磨磨磨磨磨，嗯，实际上在这个磨铅笔这个过程中呢，是吧？哈，就是让你呢，让你这个人呢，嗯，就是懂得什么，懂得一个工作方法，而且让你懂得就是怎么样在一个大的一个关系中。让你呢，能够有明察秋毫的能力，而找到这个事物的关键和深入观察的能力。
Mm-hmm. And to do these sketches is actually very time consuming. It almost seems like you're spending endless time just sharpening the pencil and on the paper. But actually, during this process, it actually teaches you how to observe the critical details.Of an object so that you can extract the essence of that object and to learn to observe things and around you in depth.
这个呢其实是中国艺术界为什么这么喜欢这个东西其实它和中国的传统的信仰传统的教育信仰其实是吻合的。
And Chinese people love this kind of art approach. It is because...It is in line with the traditional education method in China.
因为在中国传统教育中呢，实际上我发现中国传统教育它有一个很重要的特点，就是把你这人改造成一个从里到外，从生理的节奏都变成为一个有教养的人的一个过程。
Because the traditional educational method in China is to reform a person to an educated person, and this kind of reformation is almost physical.
Yeah, 比如说中国传统教育就是都是从《三字经》开始，是吧？念念念念念念，其实孩子并不懂它的内容，可是你不懂也让你念，它的目的在于让你这个孩子的说话的节奏是有文化的。
For example, the traditional educational method in China is to ask the kids to recite the three character classics. Actually, the kids, they have no idea what is the content of the three character classics, but by reciting it and by memorizing it, they learn the pace of speaking, which actually sounds very educated.
你张嘴就是有文化的。
So as soon as the kids learn to speak, because of they have already memorized the three character classics, they actually sound very as if they are very educated.
Yeah, 因为比如说中国讲书法，实际上书法呢，为什么讲童子功？说这个一看你这人字有童子功或者没有童子功，中国很讲童子功。为什么要从小训练？从小训练，实际上呢？它经过你的这种训练和拿笔这种转笔和行笔的过程呢，让你的这个肌肉都有变化。你要没有这个童子功的训练，你的肌肉是另外一回事，你要如果有童子功的训练，你的肌肉就是另外一回事，所以你一出笔，别人就觉得这个人是有文化的。
And also for Chinese calligraphy, Chinese people believe that if you want to learn calligraphy, you need to start from childhood andthat is because if you start learning, practicing calligraphy when you were very little, your muscles in your arm can actually remember how to do the writing properly. So when you are an adult and you start to do a calligraphy, experts can tell whether you have started your practice early on or not.
所以呢，就是说这一套这个西方的方法而被中国的艺术教育呢给非常喜欢的转换成了这个传统的教育的理念被灌输到这种西方教育的方法之中。
So this is a perfect combination of a Western artistic approach with the traditional Chinese educational method.
下面呢我们再谈一下这个就是说中国传统文化中的这个优质的部分和这个劣质的部分，我们做一个简单的一个分析。
Next, I would like to talk about the good points in Chinese culture and the shortcomings in Chinese culture.
这个
对，我们下面再分析一下，就是我们这个传统中到底有什么东西啊？这个我想从这件作品开始谈，就是说这个这件作品是什么呢？叫《芥子园山水卷》。
So now I would like to talk about the contents of Chinese tradition, and I would like to start from this piece of work, which is called the Mustard Seed Garden Landscape Scroll.
我只是想谈一些这个，就是我们这个文化中的一些带有特征性的东西。
This is a very characteristic piece of work in Chinese tradition.
而且这个文化中的很多东西呢，它的劣质的部分和优质的部分。往往是交接在一起的。
And we can see that the good parts in Chinese tradition and the bad parts are always interacted.
比如说这个芥子园山水卷呢，在我们读书的时候呢，在我们上美术学院学画的时候呢，这本书呢是受到批判的。我们的老师总是说，芥子园山水卷呢等于是泥古不化，就是它呢等于是一种非常保守的一个代表。
Actually, when I was studying in the Academy of Fine Arts, our teachers at that time were criticizing this piece of work, saying that it's extremely old-fashioned and extremely conservative.
但是这本书呢，现在呢，因为这么长时间的艺术实践，我发现这本书呢，其实是一个非常重要的书，而且呢，它真的是表示了中国文化中非常核心的。而且带有特质性的部分。
But after my own experience as an artist for so many years, and now I come to realize that this is an extremely important piece of work in Chinese tradition because it summarizes all the very essential and very characteristic parts of Chinese tradition.
这本书是什么呢？实际上是在这个清代吧，应该是。就是说由一个人呢他编辑了一本绘画的教科书，这本教科书呢就是把前人的大师的画法都给他分解出来，然后呢给编辑在一起。
This piece of work was done during the Qing dynasty, and somebody at that time summarized analyzed and compiled all the methods of drawing.The methods of painting from the previous masters.
而且把所有东西呢都给符号化和模板化。模板化。
And this piece of work almost changed all these techniques of drawing into symbols and models that you can copy.
比如说这个各种各样的这种点法，各种各样的点法，就是中国那个皴法、点法，最后呢这个什么什么。大魂点呀，什么什么各种各样的梧桐点呀，什么这个尖头点等等等等，他就都给你这个，就是给你这个程式化。
So on this slide, you can see the different methods to make a dot in the painting, and these are almost like models that you can copy from.
这个实际上。这是虽然是一本教画画的一本教绘画的书，但是要我看呢，这本书呢就跟字典一样的，其实它记录了描绘大千世界的符号和偏旁部首。你只要记住这个东西，而不是会学会画这个东西，而是像学字学写字一样记住这些偏旁部首，你就可以用这些偏旁部首再去组织你的这个心目中的大千世界。
So although this is an instruction book for painting, but for me this is almost like a dictionary. All these symbols in this book are like the particles in the Chinese dictionary. If, as long as you memorize these symbols, these particles, you can use them to create your own painting, to paint the world that you observe.
这是中国的艺术和西方的艺术特别不同的地方。
This is the difference between Chinese arts with the Western arts.
这个我们后边可能还会有时间呢，我们还可以谈到，比如说一个人怎么画，是吧？一个人就是独坐看花式，两个人就画成二人看云式啊，它是成式的，你知道吧？就是这个形式，你只要画两个人，你就画成这种形式，就一定不会有问题。
For example, if we look at this slide, it basically tells you that. if you are going to draw one person, one single person, and you should draw like as it shows on the right hand side, which is a person observing a flower. And as long as you are going to paint two people sitting together, and then you should do it as the left hand side shows, which are two people observing the cloud.
然后三个人怎么画, 然后四个人怎么画,
and also the same for three people and four people.
对，所以说中国绘画呢, 其实它, 它是一个非常城市化, 而且非常成熟的一个体系。
So I can say that the Chinese way approach of arts is very mature and almost programmed.
你只要按照这个程序去画, 你的东西呢就会显示出比较成熟。
As long as you follow the pattern, your work is going to appear very mature.
所以呢现在比如说我们搞当代艺术呢，要我看呢， 由于它的历史太短了，所以呢我们做的东西呢都是不成熟的。 不仅是中国的当代艺术， 包括全球的当代艺术， 其实都是带有很强的试验性 和这个不成熟性。 每做一件作品我都得重新想， 这件作品我怎么做， 我都得找到一个过去没有的方式再做。 所以呢它基本上可以说是比较幼稚的。
So this is the traditional art form in China, and now a lot of people are doing contemporary arts, not only in China but around the world. I think contemporary art works are very immature because contemporary art has a very short history, and almost all of them are very experimental. We need to think from the scratch. We are doing things that has never done, that has never been done before, so they appear to be very immature.
这个作品呢，我是这样做的，就是说我把这个书上的这些图像，按照原大又拼回到了一张长的一个手卷上，拼了一张长卷的山水长卷，然后呢，用中国传统的木刻的方法给它刻出来，然后再印出来。 对，芥子园的这幅画。
And this is one of my work. And what I did here was to take the symbols we saw from the master seed garden landscapes row, and I used the woodcut oil ink painting method to copy these images from the book and put them together onto one scroll into a new landscape painting.
最后呢，这幅画呢就成了这么一幅山水画。我们可以看到，这幅画在这里面呢，它的每一个部分呢，其实都是由不同的大家的手法画出来的。但是我给它拼在一起呢， 它仍然非常协调，我们就可以看到中国的艺术呢，它是如何的这种概念化。And
on this slide, you can see that I've copied different images from different masters in the past, and I put them together onto one piece of a paper, but they still appear to be existing in harmony with each other. So you can see that the Chinese form of art is very abstract.
我们可以看到那个树林里头这些小人啊，你看两三个人在那儿，四个人在那儿，对。
Actually, you can see the three people together and the four people getting together that I mentioned.
它是一个非常协调的。 就是一个非常成熟的体系，你给它放进去一定是很舒服的。
So this is the Chinese art form is very mature and very harmonious, and if you put them just together, they still seem to be very comfortable with each other.
这个实际上呢，这个我说的是艺术的一些案例，但实际上呢，这种思想其实贯穿在我们生活的各个方面。 Although
I was just talking about art here, but actually this kind of thinking, this sort of philosophy exists in our daily life.
比如说我们可以发现中国人说话呢很喜欢用四字成语，就是我们很喜欢把复杂的事情都用四字成语都给归纳到四字成语里面。
For example, when Chinese people talk, we love to use these four character idioms, which can summarize very complex things in just four characters.
这个，比如说这个人，比如我们说这人不孝子孙，说他不孝，但是这人怎么不孝没关系，你知道吧？他如何不孝，他如何对他爸妈不好或者怎么着，没事。但是给他归到不孝子孙里面。 它属于这一类了，那它就是这一类了。
嗯，
所以呢，就是说，这样就很简洁了，也很清楚。
嗯，
这是我们文化的思维的一个很大的一个特点。
嗯，To give an example, we will call somebody an irrespectful child of the family. It doesn't matter what he did in the past, you know, why he's irrespectful of the family.But we can just summarize this type of a person with four characters, and this is the way of thinking in Chinese culture.
这是一种工作方法和一种类型，所以我们说，中国的工作方法其实它确实带有一种模板式和简洁化。
嗯，
就是它把什么东西都套在一个简洁的一个程序中。所以呢，它不注重很多的里头到底怎么回事，分析透彻了以后才动手。他只要是一归到这一类里头，他认为是属于这一类的，他就可以开始工作。所以今天中国就发展那么快，他和这种方法其实是有关系的。
And this is also the way of working for Chinese people. Chinese people do not want to analyze things thoroughly before they start working on it. As long as they can categorize this kind of thing into one model, one category, they can start working.Right away, and that is also why I believe China could develop so fast.
另外我们一个和当今的这个当代文明有冲突的部分呢，就是我们的这种拷贝的文化。就是在中国文化中的这个拷贝是一个非常重要的文化。
And another characteristic of Chinese culture is about copying, and which I think is in contradiction with the modern culture.
这个。中国为什么这个拷贝文化这么重要？其实是和这个文化最开始的这种书写的方式其实有关系的。每一个中国人接受教育的开始的几年，其实都是在做拷贝的工作。我们要花很多年，拷贝这个模仿和拷贝这个像这个几千个汉字，是吧？每一个汉字都像一个小图画。我们就是一开始教育。的一个最开始的进入，就是说你要把这个东西给拷贝好。
The reason why copying is so important in Chinese culture, I think this is related with how we started learning to write. When Chinese kids start learning to write, they need to copy thousands of Chinese characters from the tracing books.
Yeah, 为什么要拷贝？实际上，这个文化就是尊重传统和尊重经典。
And I think this idea of copying is also related to our respect for the classics.
所以在中国的这个绘画中，这个很多的大师总是要拷贝过去的大师，而且呢，他这个题目呢就明目张胆的，就是说我临谁谁谁画艺。但是他作为自己的作品，他签自己的名字。
And also in traditional Chinese masterpieces of painting, you can see that a lot of the masters, they just copy the works of the previous masters, and they are not even ashamed of it, and the title of the masterpiece are just called, this is a copy of the previous master, and then sign their own names.
Yeah. 这个就谁这个临摹这个古人的东西好。就是说临摹的像谁就是谁的东西就有根基，就是谁的东西就受到尊重。
And the criteria for judging whether a work, a painting work is good is to see if the work actually resembles the previous masterpiece. Who can copy it the most close to the previous masterpiece who is good at painting.
就像中国的诗词，这个中国诗词讲用典。就整个中国文化的整个的中国文化就是讲究用典，就是说你古诗词，如果你用典用得好，用得绝妙，你这人的诗就好。什么叫用典呢？用典就是说用古人用过的句子来放在自己的诗里面。
And it is the same for Chinese poems. In Chinese poems, it is important to borrow from the previous poems.To borrow exactly the same sentence that previous people has used in their poems in your new poem, and if you're good at use borrowing these old classics, then you're a good poet.
所以在今天的这个版权法里面，它是要百分之多少你是从别人那抄来的，你就等于是抄袭。但是它里头有一特别的注解，就是这个不包括中国的古诗词。
For example, right now in the copyright law in China, it says that if you have a certain percentage of sentences copying from a previous work, then you are against the law. However, in the footnote, you can see that this does not apply to classic Chinese poems.
所以这个这个所以今天呢，比如说这个中国确实是它大量的这个就是说这个盗版是吧哈，什么 DVD 什么的，这个东西确实是违反了，确实是这个违反了这个当代的这个文明的一个版权法。
In China right now we can see there are a lot of pirates problems, copycat productswhich are actually against the current copyright law.
对，但是呢另外一方面呢，就是中国的年轻人是在世界上看到这个各国各国的电影，各个角落的边缘的国家的电影看得最多的。
However, on the other hand, we are also seeing that the young people in China see the largest volume of movies and works from all around the world compared to young people in other countries.
这一点呢，确实是，其实，它确实是对这个提升和这个文化的传播和这个新文明的这种传播，它确实起到了积极的作用。
And this kind of, this tradition of copying is actually very positive for spreading new culture.
当然呢，但是它和这个，实际上这个问题就是说，它和资本主义其实是一个冲突，就是这种传统的封建的一种文化特征和这个资本主义对发生一种冲突，这其实也是马克思谈到的这个东西，就是说这个就是这种东西对这种生产力的一种推动和对生产力的一种限制，对创造力的推动也对创造力的文化传播的一个限制。
However, this tradition of copying is actually against the modern capitalism, and Marx also mentioned that this tradition is, on one hand, it's promoting creativity, but on the other hand, it is also limiting creativity.
所以中国人其实很喜欢名牌，你知道吧？亚洲人其实都有点喜欢名牌。
And Chinese people and actually Asian people are very fond of big brands.
中国特别喜欢那个大牌建筑师的建筑。其实都是因为对符号，对这个经典的兴趣，就是我们很喜欢这个符号和经典，就是代表物。
And Chinese people are also very fond of buildings designed by famous architects, and this all come from the Chinese respection for symbols and for classics.
这个刚才说的这些呢，其实我们可以从这里体会到，就中国文化中的很优质的部分和很劣质的部分，它是搅在一起的。
So, from these, we can see that the good parts in Chinese tradition and the bad parts, they are actually overlap with each other.
下面呢，我再放另外一个作品。这个作品是一个 animation， 这个 animation 的题目叫 character， 就是汉字的性格。这是一个16分钟的一个 animation。实际上，我是想通过这个 animation 呢，讲什么呢？就是说，探讨中国的文化与我们的书写的方式到底是什么样的关系。
And next, I would like to show a segment of animation that I made, which is called the Character of Characters, and this explores the connection between Chinese writing and Chinese culture.
我看看它这个。Sorry. 我实际上呢，就是说，也是在谈中国文化的复杂性啊，比如说中国文化这种儒雅的文化啊，儒文化等等。这种
但实际上呢，中国的书法等等这么优雅的，但实际上它里头充满了暴力的成分和内核。
So when we talk about the Confucianism based Chinese culture, we always think that Chinese culture is very, very gentle and very elegant. However, in this very gentle and elegant culture, there are elements of violence.
比如说讲那个笔画呀、什么的，都是在谈那个高峰坠石啊、路段西向啊什么的，都是这样的描述。
For example, when we talk about the strokes in Chinese calligraphy, we talk about a dot needs to be like a falling stone from the mountain, and a leaning stroke needs to be like as sharp as the writer's sword or ivory.
实际上，中国传统就是说谈论书法作品。它确实是基本上没有说这一笔写的怎么样，那一笔写的怎么样。实际上它是，通过谈这个像魏夫人很有名的谈书法的这种理论，实际上它是在谈打仗，你知道吧？它就是通过排兵布阵，就是说怎么样排兵布阵，怎么样这种方式来谈论书法作品的。
Actually, when we talk about Chinese calligraphy, we never talk about one single stroke. For example, a very famous calligraphy critic in China, Madame Wei, when she talked about calligraphy, when she talked about the arrangement of the different strokes of the characters, she used the metaphor as of deployment of the military army.
由于这个书法呢，它的特殊性，其实呢，让中国文化的思维方式呢，它也带有特殊性。我这只举一个例子，比如说这个中国人对关系的处理，就对关系的、对什么事情之间的这种关系的这个处理呢，其实是这个很善于根据一个临时的条件来决定我现在该怎么办。这个比如说这个充分的反映在中国人的开车的方法上啊，这个这就一个美国年轻的一个支援中国的教育的一个年叫什么，他写了一个叫《寻路中国》，那里面就谈到中国人开车的身体语言，就中国人开车嘛，他很知道，就是说两个人快碰到一起的时候，他很快就可以像是开了一个会似的。马上决定你先走还是我先走。
The drivers of the two cars have a quick meeting to decide who goes first and who goes next.
Yeah, 这个东西呢是什么呢？就是说这个，这东西来自于什么呢？我觉得和我们写了几千年的书法是有关系的，因为写书法讲究什么呢？第二笔要跟着第一笔的位置来决定，第三笔根据前两笔的位置来决定的，你知道吧？最后一笔是最重要，它是保持这个书法整体上的平衡的，所以就这种长期的训练，最后真的中国文化真的不喜欢计划，也不喜欢这个，它不讲究计划，它不喜欢计划，它觉得计划的东西呢，我们写一幅书法，我先给它算出来，然后给它格子打好，然后它安排在它这笔应该在这儿，那笔应该在那儿，这一定是不好的书法，所以中国这个文化它崇尚一种。借助于这个天助，或者讲究神来之笔，你知道吧？这个东西它追求的是某一个片刻是不可重复和不可多得的，就只有你的这个身心和这个自然的节奏和自然的脉络完全成为一体的时候，你的境界是最高的。
And I think this talent of Chinese people to make the judgment based on the situation comes from thousands of years of practice of Chinese calligraphy. Because in Chinese calligraphy, you actually decide the position of the second stroke based on the position of the first stroke. And the third stroke comes from the position of the second stroke. And the last stroke of a character is the most important because it keeps the general balance of the Chinese character. So in Chinese calligraphy, we never do any planning or calculation. We do not put a grid on the piece of paper and then decide the position of the character. And you see that Chinese calligraphy is not really calligraphy. The real need of calligraphy comes only from an inspiration from the heaven, or it comes from your integration with the environment around you. It comes from that moment which cannot be replicated.
Mm. 就是今天的中国文化成为这样的一个复杂的一个状况，我觉得它真的有各种各样的不同的文化的内容混在一起。它不仅是我们学了资本主义的方法，但是呢，我们确实有很深的这个我们这文化的根性中，无法改变的一种东西，还有社会主义的这些经验。 等等等等，所有这些东西，最后让中国今天成为这个样子。
And the Chinese culture comes to the complexity of today, and it comes to the form of today. I think it actually comes from different sources. It comes from the influence of capitalism. However, it also keeps the deep root from the tradition that can never be changed, and also comes from the socialist background.
这个下面我再讲一下一个下面一个问题，就是说传统与当代的一个转换关系。这个要我看呢，就是说，当然很多很多的关于传统和当代的讨论，这个话题已经被讨论有点好像有点腻了，就是说有点好像是一个很没趣的课题。
And next, I would like to talk about the conversion between tradition and contemporary practice. And this topic has almost become a very boring cliche.
但是在我看来，传统和当代呢，其实它是一个像磁铁似的，它是由于这个磁铁的周围的这种关系的变化、引力的变化，而它是随时转换和随时变化的。
And for me, tradition and the contemporary practice are almost like two pieces of a magnet. And depending on the change of the field, and depending on the change of the force, they're continuously changing.
比如说这个，实际上这，就是说，比如说一个传统概念，在某一个时期，它就是非常传统或者没有用的，或者一个反动的思想。 但是在某一个时期，它就可以成为一个最当代的、最前沿的思想。For
example, one traditional concept at one period of time, it could be very old-fashioned and almost useless. But at another period of time, it can become extremely avant-garde.
这要看人类的文明发展到哪个阶段，而这个文明中需要调节什么东西和补充什么的东西的时候，哪个文化中有。 一种元素是可以补充和调节人类文明发展到今天，所显示出的弊病的部分。到这个时候，这个文明才开始发生作用。
It really depends on the process of the evolution of a human civilization. At one point of time, maybe the human civilization is lacking an element. And if one culture has that element, and then it can supply that need and become the most necessary piece of elements of that time.
比如说这个人类其实是发展到这个在年轻的时候需要发展这个浪漫和这个什么这种表达的时候，那法国这个民族的文化就是很善于这个东西，所以文化的中心就要跑到法国去，跑到巴黎去。
For example, at one point in time, the human civilization needs something romantic, and then the cultural center of human society shifted to France, which is very good at romance.
Yeah, 那这个你老浪漫，你老谈恋爱，你老这个表述什么抒情那也不行，你得解决吃饭的问题、生产的问题，这些问题。那这个英国的文化是吧？德国的文化就特别善于这个理性的、科学的解决人类的这个。工业文明的生产的解决人类的这个发展到现在吃饭的问题，所以文化中心就要跑到这儿来。
嗯、But human beings cannot be romantic forever. At one point, we will need production, we will need food, and that was when the cultural center of human society shifted to England and to Germany, who are very good at industrial development.
Yeah, 但是呢，这个。那个时候中国的文化呢就没有作用，为什么呢？因为中国文化讲究敬畏自然和这个天人合一，这个你整天是天人合一，这你什么都不干，那就在那个时期就属于反动的文化。
At that time, the Chinese culture was completely useless because Chinese culture is all about in harmony with nature and in harmony with heaven and respect for nature. And it was completely useless for production. So it was against the trend of cultural development at that time.
但是这个资本主义发展到现在呢，我们不能不说它其实里头又表现出来，就是说它的弊病。那这个我们的呼吸在北京就学了资本主义，最后呼吸都有问题了。这个整个人类的这种由于这个资本的利益的经济的利益的争夺，最后导致各种各样的问题和战争啊。这次威尼斯双年展的主题就是讨论这个事情。那这个时候呢，我觉得这个天人合一的思想，或者说敬畏自然的思想，我觉得就成了最当代的思想。最前卫的思想。
Capitalism was good at that time. However, after so many years of capitalism, we are also seeing the problems in capitalism. For example, in Beijing, of course, in China, we were also learning from capitalism. And now in Beijing, people cannot even breathe fresh air. And because of capitalism, we also had a lot of financial conflicts of interest, and we had wars, and this was also the theme of the Venice Biennial this year. So I think at this point, it is time for the traditional Chinese concept of respecting nature and coming into harmony with the heaven to play its role.
Yeah, 这是我理解当代和传统的一个关系，它其实是一个。这么一种关系。
So that is my understanding of the relationship between tradition and contemporary practice. It's an ever evolving relationship.
下面呢，这个作品是叫这个《何处惹尘埃》的一个作品。
And the next piece of work I would like to talk about is called Where Does the Dust Itself Collect?
下边我举几个作品的例子来谈论一下，就是说。我的艺术实践是怎么样？其实是使用这个传统的。
Next, I would like to use my own works to talk about how I used tradition in my practice.
这个作品是什么呢？就是说，因为这张图片是我纽约的工作室的楼前，我亲眼看到这两个楼怎么样倒下来的。
During 9/11, I was in New York City, and from my studio, I could see the collapse of the Twin Towers.
这个，然后呢，作为一个艺术家呢，其实面对这样的一个现场呢，你真的是不知道该怎么办，所以呢，我其实就到纽约的下城呢，去收集了一些被这个事件的这个的灰尘，因为覆盖着纽约的下城，我就收集了一包灰尘。
At that time, I think for an artist in front of this scenario, I didn't know what to do. What I did was I went to Lower Manhattan to collect some dusts.
这个，但是我有一天又读到这个铃木大拙的这个本来无一，铃木大拙翻译的这个六祖慧能的一首诗，就是这个禅诗了。叫本来无一物，何处惹尘埃？他最后有两句，所以我就又想到了这包灰尘，所以我就做了这样的一个作品。
And much later, I read a Zen poem, by Hui Neng and translated by Suzuki Daisetsu, which is called that. As there is nothing from the first, where does the dust itself collect?
Yeah. 对，我把这个尘埃呢， 这911的尘埃 给吹到这个展厅里面， 然后它落下来以后， 就是吹之前， 我先把那stencil给放好， 然后呢， 最后落完了以后， 我再把这stencil移开， 最后就是， 它就显， 由这些尘埃显示出了， 这句中国七世纪的禅语。
So the installation I had at that time was that I put the stencils first, and then I blew all the dust to the room. And after they settled, this sentence appeared on the surface.
这件作品呢, 其实它真的很安静, 也很美, 但实际上它给人一种很紧张的感觉, 就是好像一阵风吹过以后, 整个世界的状况就要变化。
This piece of work, it had this sense of serenity and peacefulness. However, it also gives you, the audience, a sense of nervousness because they feel that if there is a very small breeze in the room, this whole piece of work was going to be destroyed and the whole situation in the world was going to be changed.
这几张照片也是在那个installation一部分, 就是说明了我怎么样把这些尘埃从 纽约带到威尔士的一个过程， 这个作品最早在威尔士的国家博物馆展览的。
This installation was first on exhibition in Wales, and these photos, they show how I brought the dust from New York City to Wales.
因为把这些灰尘带到威尔士其实是很难的了， 就是它需要customer什么的。 后来我就做了一个小的一个人形， 然后把这人形带过去以后， 我们又给它碾成了一个粉末， 然后再吹到展厅里。
It was actually difficult for me to bring the dust from the States to Wales because I had to pass through the custom. So what I did was to make a toy out of the dust, and then after arrived in Wales, I asked people to grind the toy back into dust again.
这个作品其实不是在谈911事件本身， 其实在谈物质世界和精神世界。 的关系, 到底哪个是更长久和哪个更有力量。
Actually, this installation was not exploring the 911 incident itself. It was more about the exploration of the relationship between the material world and the spiritual world, which is more long-lasting, which is more powerful.
实际上当代文明呢, 有的时候呢, 它的发展呢, 让我们忘记了 就是人类最基本的和最知识性的东西。
Actually, the fast development of the modern world sometimes make people almost ignorant, or we forget the most fundamental and the intellectual parts of the world.
比如我做了这个展览以后， 然后美国的一个历史博物馆， 加州的那边的， 他给我写了一个信， 他说， 知道你做了这个作品， 你能不能卖给我们一些这个灰尘， 因为我们呢， 有一部分展览这个911， 但是我们只收集了救火队员的这些衣服啊， 什么的一些食物， 但是我们没有收集这些灰尘。
After my exhibition, I actually got a message from a history museum in California. They asked me if I could sell the dust to them because they were also having an exhibition of 911, but they only collected the clothes of the firefighters and they didn't collect any dust.
这个说明实际上就是说当代文明让我们对物质的价值其实是判断呢是有很大的出入的。
From this, I can see that because of the development of the modern world, sometimes we cannot make correct judgment of the value of the materials.
实际上在这个传统的这个宗教中， 比如说基督教也好， 犹太教也好， 什么中国的佛教也好， 印度的佛教也好， 其实对这个尘埃的这个概念其实是很相近的。
Actually, in all the major religions, so Christianity, Buddhism, and Judaism, they all have a similar concept of dust.
这个下面再讲这样一个作品，叫《地书》这个作品。
And the next work I would like to talk about is called The Book from the Ground.
因为时间的问题，可能讲的比较快啊。总的来讲，这本书呢，是我用我十多年来收集的这些标识和 icon 这些符号写的一本书。
Well, I don't have much time left, so I'll just be very fast. This is a book I wrote with the icons and the symbols I collected in the past 10 years.
这些符号呢？这是一本小说，这本小说呢讲了一个故事，一个白领，的一天的一个生活。
This is actually a novel about one day of a white collar.
实际上，我们要认真读的话，其实我们要认真读的，其实很容易读的，
And it's actually very easy to read.
我们可以简单的读一下这段，你看这个啊，很快，快进的符号大家都知道是吧？快进，然后他早上这是杀他早上起来以后去洗手间，然后那儿他好像是有点问题憋不出来，然后他在想自己的胃有什么问题这个啊，然后他在那儿待无聊就开始上那个 Facebook 什么的，是吧？然后呢，哦，他好像是解决了，然后呢，所以呢 ，even looking back， right， and。
For example, the last paragraph here is about it is the morning that the white collar he woke up, he went to the toilet, and then he couldn't make it. What happened to me? And then he was very bored sitting on the toilet, so he started to check his Facebook and other Twitter, etc. And then finally he made it, and then he used the toilet paper and flushed it.
这所有的符号都是我收集来的，没有一个是我自己创造的。
So none of the icons in the book was created by me. They were all collected from somewhere.
这本书写了有十多年，因为那时候写不出来，为什么？因为那时候没有这么多的 icon 和表情符。但是现在呢，就是我们只要把手机一拿出来，我们就在读这些 icon。
I spent over 10 years writing this book. It was because 10 years ago we did not have enough icons to make this book. But now we have much more icons and emoticons. And once we turn on our phone, we are all reading icons all the time.
我谈论这件作品呢，其实我是在想谈论什么呢？就是说，这件作品虽然非常当代，而且年轻人特别喜欢。它是一本什么呢？未来的书，就是说它在哪儿？它现在已经有很多国家的版本，比如法文的法国的出版社，这个美国的 MIT 的出版社，还有什么各种各香港的出版社，它有意思，它不用翻译这本书。
Actually, this is a book loved by young people. It is a book for the future, and it has now already been published by publishers around the world. For example, in publishers in France, in MIT in the States, and in Hong Kong, because this is a book that doesn't need to be translated.
这个我想谈这个，就是说这个它和我们的这个和我自己的传统有什么关系？实际上呢，就是说我为什么对符号 icon 这么有兴趣和那么敏感，是因为在中国的这个文化中呢，我们有读图的一个传统，就是中国的文化都读图读了好几千年了，所以呢，这个作品的虽然它是一个很当代的作品，但是它的灵感呢，其实来自于我们传统文化中的一种基因。
I want to talk about the relationship between this very contemporary piece of work with my own tradition. Actually, in Chinese tradition, we have always been reading icons because Chinese is a pictographic language, so we have thousands of years of reading icons, and that is also why I'm very interested in, and I am very sensitive to these icons.
Yeah. 这个下面还有几件作品，我想呢，就是当然呢，我像我做天书的时候，我很想做当代艺术，我很想让自己的作品非常当代，非常国际化。但是那时候我也不知道当代艺术什么样子，所以做出来的东西呢，就非常的中国。里头是充满了中国的文化和材料和以及这个中国文化中这个沟通的方法。
And I have more works here to be shown. One of my earliest pieces of work was called The Book from the Sky. At that time, I really wanted to make something that is very contemporary and very international. However, at that time, I had no clue what is supposed to be a contemporary artwork. So finally, the book From the Sky was very Chinese. It is full of Chinese culture, of Chinese materials, and the Chinese ways of communication.
这件作品呢，我也想介绍一下。它其实是我比较早的一件作品，就是它把这种中国的一种禅的思想引入了这个当代的一个 installation art.
This is also one of my early works, and this is a combination of the Chinese Zen thinking with contemporary art installation.
嗯，我其实就是一束花，一束花是由mulberry tree弄出来的，然后上面有很多的 silkworm，然后这 silkworm呢，它我们的算好时间，然后过两天它就开始吐丝了，所以这个这束花呢，就从一个茂密的，它变成了一束干枯的，由蚕茧做成的一束花。
So this piece of work is actually a bunch of mulberry leaves, and we put a silkworm on the mulberry leaves. And after some time, the silkworms, they've eaten all the leaves, and they started spinning silk and make cocoons. So this installation changed from a very lively bunch of mulberry leaves into a bunch of silkworm cocoons.
这个作品叫英文方块字书法，这是戴着面具的文字，看起来像中文，但实际上它跟中文毫无关系，它其实是英文。This
piece of work is made up of what I call the square English words, and these characters they are characters with a mask. They appear to be Chinese, but actually they're English.
比如刚才这几个字就是 art for the people.
And if you try to read these characters, they are actually art for the people.
这是我写了一本书，这本书其实是英文书。
And this is a book I wrote. It looks like a Chinese book, but it's actually an English book.
You can see the. We read from there, H, Y, D, J, right? This way is W, E, 8, O, R, B, Y, is. 这个作品是先生就把这个两种截然不同的文化硬给它压在了一起。
This piece of work is almost like forcing two completely different language into one language.
时间还是有点问题，所以我就下面再很快的讲一下这个 background story 这个作品。I'll
quickly talk about the background story, another work.
这个作品呢，实际上用一种特殊的方法来复制了中国的古代的绘画。
This work uses a very special technique to replicate classic Chinese painting.
实际上它是一种光的绘画。
And this is actually what I call a painting of lights.
我们看到的不是真正的绘画，而是一个由这个光构成的一种不存在的绘画。
What we see here is not an actual painting. It is a painting made up of the shadow and the light.
你看这是由这些东西弄成的。
So if you see from behind, they're actually made up of these branches and the
我们把这个玻璃呢，给改成了 Milky Glass。 然后我们用一些这个现成的自然的物呢放在后面。如果你隔这个 Milky Glass 特别近，它前面就有一个特别清楚的形象；如果比较远，它就会 blurry，它就像中国的山水画一样。So
actually, what we did was to put a Milky Glass panel in the front, and then put some natural debris behind it. And if the natural debris is very close to the glass, then the lines are very sharp. However, if you give certain distance between the glass and the natural debris, then they appear to be blurred and almost like a classic Chinese ink landscape painting.
这是我们在室外，就是和这个自然的这个树林，和这个树木，利用这个东西做起来的一幅画。所以这个时候呢，利用自然的光线，这幅画就变得非常的丰富。早晨到晚上和四季都是不同的。
And this is an outdoor installation. We used the woods in the background as part of the installation. So it was always changing with the light and changing with the season.
下面还有一些试验，这是这个就是像education 部分，我们这些画底下那些材料就是做的，就像有点像一个魔术师做了一个魔术，然后最后又告诉咱们这魔术是怎么做出来的。
And these are actually, it's almost like a magician telling the audience what he did. So we put the materials under the paintings.
这都是我们很快的过。这是做的一幅很大的一幅富春山居图。
And this is also a very big scroll of a classic Chinese landscape painting.
我们可以看到这是背面。然后这是正面。
From behind, from front.
其实我们的工作就是调节空间中的光的状况。
Our work was to adjust the space and the light.
这张大千的一幅画。
This is a masterpiece of the Chinese painter 张大千。
我们看其实它很生动，但是呢它都是由这些现成物做出来的。
And it's a very vivid painting, and it's made up of existing materials in nature.
我其实有时候在想，为什么用这种方法可以复制中国画，而不能复制欧洲的古典的油画？虽然古典油画是写实的。
Sometimes I'm thinking why I could use this method to replicate classic Chinese painting, but I cannot replicate with these materials a classic European oil painting.
今天没有时间，所以就这个就不多谈。这幅画其实是利用这个一个美术馆的这个实际的建筑的玻璃做出来的，它从外面可以看到这个作品。
This work is I used the glass door of gallery, and you can see the painting from outside of the building.
总的来说呢，我是想说什么呢？就是说啊，中国传统中啊有很优秀的东西，也有很糟粕的东西，但是实际上我们并不知道这个文化中真正哪些东西是优质的，是有用的。
I don't have much time left, but in general what I want to say is that there are a lot of good things in Chinese culture that we can learn from, but of course there are also things that we do not need. However, we actually do not understand which are the good parts that we can take from.
但是即使我们知道哪些东西是好东西，但是呢，我们呢，没有使用它的经验。
Even though we actually know which are the good parts, we do not have the experience utilizing them.
因为我们过去的一二百年，其实我们的精力都用在如何学习西方的文明上。
Because we spent the past two centuries learning from Western culture.
我们积累了很多学习西方的经验，但是我们确实没有积累如何使用我们自己文化的经验。
We accumulated a very rich experience of learning and utilizing Western culture, but we did not have any experience of using our own tradition.
Yeah. 中国文化中讲究这个体和用的关系。昨天和汉斯教授其实在晚餐那儿谈到这个，就是体呢就是一个系统，一个体系，一个框架，而用呢就是实际的操作，这两个都很重要。但是呢就是说其实由于西方文化的影响和强大呢，中国文化这个体已经是不完善了。
Yesterday I was discussing with a Chinese study scholar about the two parts of culture. First part is the framework, and the second part is to put the framework into practice. And because of the very strong influence from Western culture, and currently the framework of Chinese culture is already broken.
对，所以你看，我们中国人其实都不知道怎么该穿衣服。这个你穿唐装也是很难受。但是正式场合你穿西装，好像你又没有了民族的一种，是吧？一种，反正都不对，怎么着不对？就是说明这只是一个例子。实际上，其实中国的现在很多事情怎么都不对，其实是因为我们这个体被破坏了。
And because our framework is broken, and currently, Chinese people always feel they are almost in a dilemma. For example, we don't know how to dress up. In a very formal occasion, and to wear a Western suit seems that we have lost our cultural identity. However, if we actually wear a costume from the Tang Dynasty, it also seems very eccentric.
所以呢，我其实做了很多的艺术实践，其实都是在通过每一个 project， 都是在探索我们这个文化中到底有什么东西是我们不知道的。嗯。
So I have done a lot of artistic projects, and from each experiment, I have always been exploring what are the unknown parts in our culture.
嗯，好吧，安斯教授，那就我就先讲到这儿。嗯，是不是还有时间做 Q&A？
对，谢谢。